Hello, my name is Sam Felton, and welcome to Expert Interviews here on Smash the Fat. With me today is a very special guest who isn't our usual type of guest. Usually it's just people within the health and fitness community, but today I'm glad to present to you all the way from Boston, business consultant Steve Shapiro. How are you doing, Steve?
I'm doing fantastic. How are you doing?
Yeah, really good, really good. It's fantastic to have you on the show. And just to give a bit of background for people to find out, why exactly are we having a business consultant come on our health and fitness podcast? You actually feature in my book, Slimology, where I talk about kind of maybe the detrimental effects of kind of specific goal setting, because goal setting in health and fitness can be relatively detrimental, and it's actually something I'm going to be talking about at this big fitness conference this year called FitPro. But with weight loss, you don't exactly know how much you're going to be losing. So what I recommend is meandering with purpose, which is something that you talk about in your book, Goal-Free Living. And we actually use these personal purpose credit cards that people can put in their wallet. They just write down their purpose for better health and a slimmer body in their credit card, in their wallet or purse, so they can kind of see it on a daily basis, and then they kind of meander with purpose from there. And I find that to be a lot more productive and a lot less stressful. So we're going to be talking about goal-free living, which coincidentally is the name of one of your second book. But kind of before we get into all of that, and I now come to the end of that rather long introduction, how exactly did you get into goal-free living in the first place?
So actually what I am is an expert on innovation. So I've dedicated my life to helping people think differently. And one of the things I did back in 2003 was I hopped in my car and I drove across the country and I interviewed about 150 really creative people. And in the process of interviewing all these really creative people, one of the things that I found was that the most creative people didn't have goals. And then I started to see that the most successful people didn't have goals. So it wasn't setting out to write a book on goals or anything like that. It was actually a book on innovation and creativity, and just turned out to be that way.
Yeah, and then kind of when did the book start to take formation? Because you did this fantastic survey on people to find out kind of maybe the cognitive dissonance that's going on, that people feel like they have to set goals, yet it makes them more stressed, and one of their goals is to be less stressed.
Right.
So what were your findings on that?
Well, we did a number of surveys, but you know, as we started developing the book, we realized, well, let's get some statistics behind this. And you know, I mean, we found that like 92% of the people who set New Year's resolutions, for example, fail to achieve them. Most people who set their goals don't achieve their goals. And then when they look at, this was sort of the fascinating part of it all, is if the objective of setting a goal is partly about the goal, but usually we set a goal because it makes us feel good when we achieve the goal, what we found is that most people don't achieve their goals, and if they're not achieving their goals, then they're actually creating a level of dissatisfaction in their life. So that's, you know, sort of this ironic paradox that we see, is that we set goals to be happy, yet we're less happy in the process of setting goals.
Absolutely, and that's kind of one of the reasons that I really kind of discourage people from setting specific weight loss goals, because the human body is a unpredictable biological system. You can't exactly tell how much you're going to lose. So if you set a goal of, say, you want to lose 10 pounds in 10 weeks, and you kind of only get to 7 pounds, then you feel that dissatisfaction. Or on the flip side, you know, you stop yourself eating completely, so that you achieve the goal, but you compromise your health at the same time. So do you kind of see that in your day-to-day work in business and things like that?
Well, absolutely. It's sort of the paradox of goal setting, is that when you set a goal, we compromise the process. So there's the outcome and then there's the process. And if we focus solely on the outcome, we will in many cases do things to achieve an outcome that is actually harmful to us in the long run. So it achieved that goal, but it compromised other goals. Like you were saying, if it's health, we will set a goal to lose a certain amount of weight. In the process of doing that, we end up doing things which harm our body in the long run and probably cause us to put on more weight in the long run. And here's actually a really interesting thing is what we find is that people who focus on the goal are in many cases less likely to achieve the goal. I'll give you one non-health example in sales. We've actually done studies and found that people who are hyper-focused on achieving a sales target, like I must sell this much, sell worse than people who are actually evaluating themselves or being evaluated by others on how well they serve people. So the objective here is how do we serve others? How do we serve ourselves rather than how do we achieve a particular objective? That's sort of this weird thing that we see is focusing on the goal actually hurts our ability to achieve that goal.
Absolutely. So kind of in relation to New Year's resolutions, which I'm sure many people have kind of set in the past couple of weeks and are trying to achieve, how can people actually kind of go about trying to achieve something rather than just kind of, you know, setting these specific goals and then either getting dissatisfied or compromising themselves in the process?
So one of the things that I always suggest, and it's pretty similar to what you were talking about before, is you want a theme. And a theme is not a specific measurable outcome, like I want to lose a certain amount of weight, or I want to stop doing this, or I want to start doing this. But actually, it's a theme which allows you to allow life to unfold. And for example, you know, people have had themes of health as a general theme. Now, health as a theme might be too broad because it may not actually have you change your behaviors. But let's say you're going on a vacation. Maybe it's just, you know, bikini ready is what you're looking at. So you're just sort of getting in this mindset of, am I doing everything? You sort of visualize yourself in the bikini. It's not about getting down 10 pounds, but it's just getting healthy to look good. So, you know, I always set New Year's themes, not New Year's resolutions. And my themes are essentially one word that will describe how my year is going to go. And I post those in different places and remind myself of how I want to live my life.
That's fantastic. And what are the themes for this year, Steve?
So I have three themes. Well, actually two. One is sort of two words. And I like it because it's a sort of a paradox of things is sophisticated innocence. And I know to most people it's going to make absolutely no sense. But the concept of innocence I love because it is about being childlike and looking at the world with fresh eyes and not being jaded by the world around us. So I love that concept of innocence, and I want to bring that level of innocence to everything I do, but I don't want to be childlike, so I want to be sophisticated in the way I am childlike. So sophisticated innocence is one of them for me, which is how do I still be a kid at heart, yet still be an adult in the way I live? And then the other one is unmasking, which is sort of a strange word, but as a professional speaker, I'm on stage and we have a facade that we put up and we always are so worried about how we're perceived by others and, you know, do we look good? And so this year I basically want to say, screw it. You know, I'm not going to worry about how I look in the eyes of others. I'm going to do the best I can do, be the best person I can, try to eliminate the facade, remove the mask and just have a great life and contribute as much as I possibly can.
Absolutely. And one of the secrets in the book, Goal Free Living, is about seeking out adventure. And that's kind of the sense that I get from you there is that, you know, the journey is just as important as the destination. So kind of being mindful of your situation and trying to seek out new things that you didn't think of in the first place when you kind of set your theme or your purpose in the first place.
Yeah, I mean, like I said, the book wasn't supposed to be a book on goal setting. The book was supposed to be a book on creativity. And if you think about it, Steve Jobs once said, creativity is just having enough dots to connect. Dots being ideas or experiences. And the reason why creative people are so is they've either had more experiences or they've thought more about their experiences than other people. And so I would argue that the creative people are the ones who have the most experiences and actually reflect upon those experiences and look to make connections between those experiences. So that's why I think adventure is great. And I also believe that what it does is it expands our mind to be able to look at the world differently, which then allows us to develop creative solutions to whatever we're working on.
Definitely, because you can't tell when you first set out a goal of, say, £10 in 10 weeks. You can't tell kind of down that road that your weight loss might stop at £7, but you might feel the best you ever have. And because you feel so great, you go out for a walk in the park and then you bump into an old friend that you didn't see in a long time. And then you end up going for a coffee and then, you know, just reminiscing on things like that. And you just don't know exactly what's going to happen from that initial idea of, okay, I just want to be a bit healthier. You know, you can't plan those things.
Well, that's a great point. I mean, I think what we're looking to do with our life is be successful, and successful in the broadest term. I don't mean financially successful, but successful means having great relationships, having a great relationship with your body. It's about having the career that you love and jazzes you up. And I'm a big believer that we can never predict what is going to actually make us successful. I mean, we can set plans. We can, you know, try to lay out the way the future should be for us. It doesn't tend to happen the way we expect it to. So the best thing we can do is, again, this concept of meandering with purpose. It's not, and I want to be very clear, there is a big difference between goal-less living and goal-free living. Goal-less living is sitting on your butt eating bonbons and watching television all day.
Yeah.
Goal-free living is having a sense of direction, not a specific destination, and you allow life to unfold. You meander with purpose, as you said. You allow life to unfold. And in the unfolding, things you'd never thought of, things you'd never conceived before, start to show up. And that's what we're really talking about here. How do you allow the unpredictable to manifest itself in your life? And that can only happen by doing things that are unpredictable. If you're only doing what's on your plan, you're only going to get things that are predictable. And guess what? Even if you achieve your plan, it's been proven that there's actually scientifically less satisfaction, because when you start to create the plan, you sort of almost expect the plan. So when you achieve the goal of the plan, it's in your mind that I should have been doing that anyway. Whereas if you allow life to unfold and you achieve the unexpected, that creates and lights up the brain in different ways, which then stimulates us to want to do more.
That's so true, because when I finished university and graduated, the next day I went took a train down to Land's End, which is the most southern part of England, and from there I walked all the way to northern Scotland, so the most southerly point to the most northerly point in Scotland, so a journey of 1,000 miles from Land's End to John O'Groats. And when I got to John O'Groats, it was almost a bit of an anti-climax, because, you know, that was it. I knew that was going to happen, you know. But the really exciting part was the part in the middle. It was the journey, the people that I met. It was random people that I met that just said, hey, you know, if you want a place to stay tonight, you can stay at ours. And just had these fascinating conversations with people. And there's one in particular where I was kind of in, you know, the West Highlands of Scotland, and came across this gamekeeper who was just out hunting. And basically I was saying, you know, do you have a bed that I could crash on tonight? And he was like, yeah, sure, put your rucksack in the back of the Land Rover. Opens up the back of the Land Rover, 3 stag heads kind of in the back with blood all over the back of the Land Rover. So I kind of put it in gingerly and like expecting myself to be kind of murdered that night. But no, he was a very nice guy. We watched a soccer match, football match, and had a fantastic time. But, you know, if I'd have thought kind of at the beginning I'd end up in some gamekeeper's house and kind of, you know, going on all these adventures, you know, you just can't plan for that. And that's what enriches a journey like that. And you talk about using a compass rather than a map, and that's almost exactly what I did on that journey.
Yeah, I mean that's a perfect. I mean that's the first tip in the book, which is use a compass, not a map. And basically, what it is instead of a specific destination, what you want to do is have a sense of direction, and then meander with purpose. And again, the whole point here is to allow the unpredictable to show up. And so that's essentially, you know, what you did. I wrote the book, actually, it's interesting, the book became sort of a microcosm of how I live my life. June 5th, 2003, I hopped in my car, I drove across the country, and over the course of 3 months, I never knew where I was gonna sleep each night. I would literally, when I got to a city and I decided this is where I was gonna stay, I'd pull over to the side of the road. I had my car wired up, now it's not a big deal, but back then I actually had GPS and internet access in my car, which, you know, over, you know, 12 years ago is pretty high tech. And I would book a room, you know, from the side of a road while I was pulling into a city. And it was a pretty amazing trip. It was just totally unpredictable. And what happened out of it, I thought was just, you know, more spectacular than I would have had I said, well, I'll be here on this day and here on this day. These are the people I'm meeting. I'm a big believer in just letting things unfold.
Absolutely. Kind of part of that process, though, as well, is that you learn a lot about yourself and kind of your strengths and your weaknesses. And you talk about kind of embracing your limits as well.
Yeah, I mean, that chapter is actually originally called Embracing Your Inadequacies. And it's, you know, there. Well, and it comes back to even my theme for the year, now that you mention it, which is about we all have something which we want to hide from others. Mm-hmm. And in the process of trying to hide that, you know, so we can call it an inadequacy, we can call it a limit, we can call it a limiting belief, but in the process of trying to hide that, it sometimes manifests itself even worse, either in the eyes of others or in your eyes, and causes you to do things which are unhealthy. So I'll give you a very personal story. I wrote about it recently. One of my limiting beliefs was that I was a fake, a fraud, and an imposter, and that everything I wrote was total BS, and that nobody should believe a word I'm saying. And so, and it wasn't true, but it's how mm-hmm. I related, because I was supposed to be the expert to the experts to the experts, and it was, mm-hmm. at some point you just say, well, I can't be that smart. So, and I'm not saying I am, but what happened was when I believed I was an imposter, there's actually something called the imposter syndrome, I try to hide that. So I had this really big mask, this big protective shell around me to prevent people from getting in to get to know me, because if they got to know me, they'd figure out I was a fraud. And then several years ago, I decided this is killing me, because when I'm on stage giving a speech, I am so worried that somebody's going to figure out I'm a fake. I'm so worried that I'm going to say something and everybody's going to figure things out. And so I'm living life waiting for the other shoe to drop, worrying about people figuring me out. And then eventually I said, you know what? I'm not going to deal with this anymore. So I started telling everybody I knew this is how I felt. And a couple of interesting things happened. One was I found out that a lot of my speaking buddies, people who are some of the smartest people I've met in my life, have exactly the same thing. In fact, I found that so many people really question when everybody else looks at you as an expert and you don't feel that way, that's actually an extremely common occurrence. Mm-hmm. So that was the first thing I noticed, is I could actually connect with people deeper. But the funny thing is, in the process of letting go of it, by embracing it and sharing it, it went away and I don't have it anymore. Or at least not often. Occasionally, you know, get that little voice, but for the most part, it's gone, and my speeches have been better. My content has been better. I feel freer, lower stress. I don't worry about things. So when we have something that holds us back, it prevents us from living the way we want to live.
That's rather fascinating, and kind of, I suppose, you're quite right. We all feel that, you know, we're just kind of frauds, and why should anybody believe us? I mean, it's even in the face of scientific evidence, you know. You've managed to kind of flick through my book, read my book, and kind of seeing the evidence that I kind of present there, which is, you know, 25 randomized controlled trials between low carb and low fat, and, you know, funnily enough, low carb wins every time, and despite eating similar amounts of calories, they lose more weight. But then you kind of, you have haters and critics who will say, yeah, you're full of nonsense and things like that, and you start to believe it because it gets repeated a fair few times. And so kind of how else do you recommend people to kind of overcome those limiting beliefs apart from kind of just embracing it?
Well, and it's tough because as human beings, we do have something which is called the negativity bias. Yeah. So you write a book, and I don't know if you're like me, but I don't look at the 5-star reviews. I look at the 1-star reviews, and I'm thinking, oh, they know something. Everybody else, they're the idiots. The 1-star review people, they're the ones who are... And it's not the case. Everybody just has a different opinion on things. You know, if I'm writing a book on not having goals, I'm going to piss off the people who think that goals are the key to the universe. So I'm not sure I have the answer to that other than to just say, look, we have these limiting thoughts and beliefs. And again, it's not, they're not necessarily bad. Sometimes they will drive us to do great things. But what I try to do is really, I try to focus less and less on things that are negative in general. I don't watch the news anymore. I mean, I just figured, you know what?
I don't.
there's no value to me in hearing about all the horrible things in the world because I can't change it. It doesn't help me. Therefore, why should I bother with it? So I'm trying to, because I think what happens, especially in this society, is we get bombarded with so many negative messages. You know, all the haters, as you were saying, and all the bad news and all the bad reviews. People love to just spout off negativity. So for me, a lot of the best way to embrace your power is to actually stop getting into the habit of embracing negativity. And I really just focus on positive things. So one of the other tips in the book is to, instead of having what you want, it's to want what you have. And it's about really just saying, I am going to embrace what I have in my life and love what I have and appreciate what I have. And that's, to me, really the key.
Absolutely. And it's quite interesting because a lot of people think that they're not going to be able to achieve things because they don't have certain things. They'll put their motivational stimulus on having something before they go to another step. But entrepreneurs don't often do that. They use the bird in hand principle. They kind of use what they have at hand to create something which will kind of take them to the next level. So it's kind of about using the resources that you've currently got. And in terms of health and fitness, you don't need a gym membership. You don't even need any fitness equipment. Your body has everything you need to be able to kind of do some form of exercise, whether that be just a bit of a walk or just some press ups and some squats, and even kind of, you know, going to a local park and doing some chin ups, ideally as well. So it's kind of about exactly what you said there, looking at what you've got, and then trying to create plans on, you know, how you can do certain things from that almost on a daily basis.
Yeah, and you know, and I'm going to be clear, when it comes to health and wellness, I am far from an expert because I don't necessarily have the best habit.
That's why I'm
a I am a low carb guy. I've always been a believer in that. I know for my body that certainly works. And I tend to use that, but I, you know, it's really tough to get me to go to the gym.
Sure.
But I have a boxing bag here, so I will, you know, I love to punch.
Perfect.
So I'll punch that, you know, so I put on my gloves and I'll do that for 15 minutes. And so I find for me, I have to do things that call me. My favorite thing is I live about 5 minutes from a beach. I love walking the beach for a couple of hours. So even just things like that. So I have a gym membership. I'm pathetic in the amount of times that I've used it.
Sure.
But hopefully I move my body enough in other ways that it compensates for the fact that I'm not getting the money out of my gym membership. I keep it, though, in the hope I actually go someday.
I'll get you on track, Steve. Don't worry. Don't worry about that. When it comes to food and things like that, I think it's a similar thing. It's not about being, you know, like a gourmet chef and trying to make these fantastical meals. When you're a time-pressed home cook, it's about making simple dishes that are tasty, satisfying, and kind of looking at what's in the fridge and in the cupboard, and then just making something from there. You don't need to be doing these amazing things. You can just have a steak and some green vegetables and kind of cover it in butter, and that's your job done. Some salt and pepper and any other herbs and spices that you want. That's all you need to be doing. It doesn't need to be amazing. It just needs to be kind of the basics, and get that right is the most important thing. Is it similar in business? Because you've worked with some amazing clients like NASA, GE, Johnson & Johnson, and all these massive companies. What's it like kind of speaking to those people, to those companies, and trying to figure out how you can help them?
Well, it's interesting. I mean, when you're an individual, you have much more say over your life and your actions. When you're in a big company, things do get homogenized down into the culture which drives things. Hmm. So it's a little more difficult to make change happen in big companies, which is why we typically try to get the top people in the company to try to initiate the change and drive what matters most. Mm-hmm. So what we're really looking at in big companies is, first of all, the key thing is that what I talk about is you can't be the best at everything. And I would say as an individual, this is also true. We can't be great at everything. We can only be great at certain things. So the question is, how do we figure out what we are best at? Or in the case of a big company, how do we figure out what we need to be best at? I always say innovate where you differentiate. That is, how do we set ourselves apart from others and really focus our energies on our differentiator? So that's really the key thing. And then once you do that, become masterful at anything that truly sets you apart from everyone else, and then find other people to work with at everything else. And I think the same thing is true, though, as individuals, is there are things which we are great at. We can't be great at everything. So I'm always looking at, well, if I'm not good at finance, for example, that's fine. I don't need to be great at finance. I need to be a great speaker. I don't have to even be the best at marketing. I hire people to help me market. I hire help people to keep me on track with my schedule. Those are the people that I look to help me. So I figure out what I'm best at, and then I partner with other people. And I think the same thing is true with companies. Always figure out what is most important for you to do that only you can do that will truly set you apart. And then don't worry about everything else as long as you have someone else that you're working with.
Definitely. I mean, if you are kind of having trouble with your health and fitness, it's kind of probably a wise idea to almost outsource that to someone else as well, by going to either kind of, some sort of support group or seeing a friend that can kind of keep you accountable or something like that, or coming to a group exercise class such as ours, and then kind of, allowing them to kind of almost take control of your health to a certain extent. Obviously, there's kind of some sort of compromise there where, that person can't be there 24/7, but that's kind of my ideas on health and fitness. What are your kind of initial ideas on that?
Yeah, absolutely. And if I look at companies, part of the reason why companies work the way they work is that they do have this sort of a checks and balance, and that you get some people who are good at some things and people who are good at the other thing. But the other thing which really helps at work is that everybody's working, towards something that they're trying to do for the organization. And so I've got some feedback. Is everything clear on your side with the sound?
Yeah, that's all good.
Okay, good. As long as it's good for you, I just wanted to make sure. So one of the things that we're always looking at is because if you have one person who is really masterful at something and they get rewarded for it, other people become inspired by that and want to sort of follow in their shoes. So we do get this multiplier effect that happens inside of organizations, where as we start to recognize and reward the behaviors that we like, other people see that. They say, oh, that's good. I want to be one of those people. So we get inspired by people around us. So like you were talking about, when you work together in a gym or a fitness program, you have accountability, but it also creates aspirations. And I love to be around people. I'm in several mastermind groups. And mastermind groups are people who are sort of like-minded. Maybe they're professional speakers. Maybe they're business entrepreneurs. We get together on a regular basis. We don't hold each other accountable. There are some masterminds that do that. Mm-hmm. But what we do is we raise the level of our game. Because if I'm hanging around with people who are at the top of their game, it raises my game. And I'm good at some aspects and they're good at some aspects. So we raise each other up. That to me is the key for any organization, is to really figure out where do you want to raise people? What are the attributes and behaviors that you're looking for in people?
And then you kind of cultivate it from there, basically, don't you? And trying to see the leaders and trying to get them to try and bring everybody up kind of to the same level, and then everybody kind of comes up and, as you say, raises their game. And then in regard to health and fitness, everybody becomes healthier and fitter in a group that's getting healthier and fitter as well.
Absolutely.
So
it's like the concept of all boats rise with the tide type of thing. And that's what we're looking to do. And it's why in big companies, the leader of the organization is so important. You know, sometimes somebody will bring me in and they're at a relatively lower part of the business. And they'll say, hey, how do we become more innovative? It's going to be really difficult to do it if you don't have the support from the top, because you really need somebody who's going to set that direction. Again, goal-free living isn't about having a specific destination, but it is a sense of direction. And you need to make sure that everybody's rowing in the same direction. It might not be in a straight line, but you need to make sure you have a sort of know where you're going, and without good leadership, we're rowing in multiple directions. And so I think the same thing is true with everything we do in our life, is we just need to make sure we have that direction, you know, and be inspired by other people. And good leaders, whether it's someone like yourself who leads a group of people, whether it's a leader who leads a group of employees in a company, they help everybody row in the right direction, inspires them and lifts them up, and at the same time gives them the tools to make it happen.
That's absolutely beautiful, Steve, and I think that's a good place to stop, because, you know, the bottom line here is that people kind of need to figure out a direction in which they're going to go, and it's just the direction that you need. It's not really the destination, and if you're kind of in a group, it is just like rowing a boat. You know, you're not going to be going in a dead straight line, but as long as you're kind of all rowing in the same direction, you'll get there together in the end as well, really, I suppose, isn't it? Spot on, Steve. So people can grab your fantastic book on Amazon if they're in the UK. If they want to help support the show as well, they can go through smashthefat.com/GFLUK, and if you're in the US, go via smashthefat.com/GFLUS, and that'll take you through to Amazon and help support the show at the same time when you make that purchase of Steve's book, Goal Free Living. And then people can find you at steveshapiro.com as well, can't they?
Correct, yep.
Cool. And any other places where it's best to get in contact with you and check out all your stuff?
I would say steveshapiro.com is the best place. There you can find my Twitter links and my LinkedIn articles and everything else that I do. So if you start there, that's the gateway into everything else that I do.
Into the Shapiro universe. Fantastic.
Yes.
Super. So there's only one more thing to do, Steve, and that's to hear a smash it out from you. So on three, I want you to shout, smash it out to the camera. So one.
Smash it out?
Yeah, smash it out. That's right. One, two, three.
Smash it out.
Whee! That's what I'm talking about. Fantastic, Steve. So again, everybody go check out steveshapiro.com as well as his book, Goal Free Living, on Amazon via smashthefat.com/GFLUK. or GFLUS if you're in the US. It's been fantastic speaking to you today, Steve, and have a fantastic day, and I'm sure I'll speak to you soon.
Thanks, Sam. I really enjoyed it.
Fantastic. See you, mate.